Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Map of Salt and Stars, a novel by Zeyn Joukhadar. Read by Lara, Sawalha.
For the Syrian people, both in Syria and in diaspora, and for all refugees. Part 1. Syria. O beloved, you are dying of a broken heart. The women wail in the street. The rice is scattered and the lentils spilt. The good linen is trampled. The wadi runs with tears. In what language did you tell me that all we loved was a dream? I don't dream in Arabic anymore. I don't dream at all. When I close my eyes, I see yours, beloved. Two pale stones in the river. Your arms, the cracked marble of centuries. The stars, your blanket. The hills, stepping stones. We used to move so fast when we were dreaming. Cup the sea in your navel and wash away my tears. My tears and yours mingle, beloved. I did not want to sleep, not now, but I must. Why do we fear death when we should fear falling down? It all collapses around us. Your whispering green, the arc of lightning in your wrists. The ransomed planets twist away. Is this where my mother was born? In the curve of your spine? I bleed. My flesh is teething wings. Until the dawn when I flee, never will I return, O beloved. Until that morning, wrap your pale hands around me. Fill my mouth with the fog of your breath, your heart a pomegranate seed. O beloved, you are with me to the end. Until the sea divides, until our broken memory makes us whole. The Earth and the Fig. The island of Manhattan's got holes in it, and that's where Baba sleeps. When I said goodnight to him, the white bundle of him sagged so heavy, the hole they dug for him so deep. And there was a hole in me too, and that's where my voice went. It went into the earth with Baba, deep in the white bone of the earth, and now it's gone. My words sunk down like seeds, my vowels and the red space for stories crushed under my tongue. I think Mama lost her words too, because instead of talking, her tears watered everything in the apartment. That winter, I found salt everywhere. Under the coils of the electric burners, between my shoelaces and the envelopes of bills, on the skins of pomegranates in the gold-trimmed fruit bowl. The phone rang with calls from Syria, and Mama wrestled salt from the cord, fighting to untwist the coils. Before Baba died, we hardly ever got calls from Syria, just emails. But Mama said in an emergency, you've got to hear a person's voice. It seemed like the only voice Mama had left spoke in Arabic. Even when the neighbor ladies brought casseroles and white carnations, Mama swallowed her words. How come people only ever have one language for grief? That winter was the first time I heard Abu Sayyid's honey yellow voice. Huda and I sat outside the kitchen and listened sometimes. Huda's ash-brown curls crushed against the door jamb like spooled wool. Huda couldn't see the color of his voice like I could. But we'd both know it was Abu Sayyid calling because Mama's voice would click into place. Like every word she'd said in English was only a shadow of itself. Huda figured it out before I did. That Abu Sayyid and Baba were two knots on the same string. A thread Mama was afraid to lose the end of. Mama told Abu Sayyid what my sisters had been whispering about for weeks. The unopened electricity bills, the maps that wouldn't sell, the last bridge Baba built before he got sick. Abu Sayyid said he knew people at the university in Homs, that he could help Mama sell her maps. He asked, what better place to raise three girls than the land that holds their grandparents? When Mama showed us our plane tickets to Syria, the O in my name, Nour, was a thin blot of salt. My older sisters, Huda and Zahra, pestered her about the protest in Dar'a, things we had seen on the news. But Mama told them not to be silly, that Dar'a was as far south of Homs as Baltimore was from Manhattan. And Mama would know, because she makes maps for a living. Mama was sure things would calm down, that the reforms the government had promised would allow Syria to hope and shine again. And even though I didn't want to leave, I was excited to meet Abu Sayyid, excited to see Mama smiling again. I had only ever seen Abu Sayyid in Baba's Polaroids from the 70s, before Baba left Syria. Abu Sayyid had a mustache and an orange shirt then, laughing with someone out of frame, Baba always just behind him. Baba never called Abu Sayyid his brother, but I knew that's what he was, because he was everywhere. Eating iftar on Ramadan evenings, playing cards with Sitto, grinning at a cafe table. Baba's family had taken him in. They had made him their own. When spring came, the horse chestnut trees bloomed white like fat grains of rock salt under our window. We left the Manhattan apartment and the tear-encrusted pomegranates. The plane's wheels lifted like birds' feet, and I squinted out the window at the narrow stripe of city where I'd lived for 12 whole years, and at the hollow green scooped out by Central Park. I looked for Baba, but with the city so far down, I couldn't see the holes anymore. Mama once said the city was a map of all the people who'd lived and died in it. And Baba said every map was really a story. That's how Baba was. People paid him to design bridges, but he told his stories for free. When Mama painted a map and a compass rose, Baba pointed out invisible sea monsters in the margins. The winter before Baba went into the earth, he never missed a bedtime story. Some of them were short, like the one about the fig tree that grew in Baba's backyard when he was a little boy in Syria. And some of them were epics, so twisting and incredible that I had to wait night after night to hear more. Baba made my favorite one. The story of the mapmaker's apprentice lasts 2 whole months. Mama listened at the door, getting Baba a glass of water when he got hoarse. When he lost his voice, I told the ending. Then the story was ours. Mama used to say stories were how Baba made sense of things. He had to untangle the world's knots, she said. Now, 30,000 feet above him, I'm trying to untangle the knot he left in me. He said one day, I tell our story back to him. But my words are wild country, and I don't have a map. I press my face to the plane window. On the island under us, Manhattan's holes look like lace. I look for the one where Baba is sleeping and try to remember how the story starts. My words tumble through the glass, falling to the earth. August in Homs is hot and rainless. It's been 3 months since we moved to Syria, and Mama doesn't leave her tears on the pomegranates anymore. She doesn't leave them anywhere. Today, like every day, I look for the salt where I left my voice, in the earth. I go out to the fig tree in Mama's garden, standing heavy with fruit, just the way I imagined the fig Baba once had in his backyard. I press my nose to the fig's roots and breathe in. I'm belly down, stone heat in my ribs, my hands up to the knuckles in reddish dirt. I want the fig to carry a story back to Baba on the other side of the ocean. I lean in to whisper, brushing the roots with my upper lip. I taste purple air and oil. A yellow bird taps the ground, looking for worms. But the sea dried up here a long time ago. if it was ever here at all. Is Baba still lying where we left him, brown and stiff and dry as kindling? If I went back, would I have the big tears I should have had then? Or is the sea dried up in me forever? I rub the smell of water out of the fig's bark. I'll tell Baba our story. And maybe I'll find my way back to that place where my voice went. And Baba and I won't be so alone. I ask the tree to take my story and its roots and send it down where it's dark, where Baba sleeps. Make sure he gets it, I say. Our favorite, about Rawiya and Al-Idrisi? The one Baba told me every night, the one where they mapped the world. But the earth and the fig don't know the story like I do. So I tell it again. I start the way Baba always did. Everybody knows the story of Rawiya, I whisper. They just don't know they know it. And then the words come back like they had never left, like it had been me telling the story all along. Inside, Huda and Mama clank wooden bowls and porcelain. I forgot all about the special dinner for Abu Sayyid tonight. I might not be able to finish the story before Mama calls me in to help, her voice all red edges. I press my nose to the ground and promise the fig I'll find a way to finish. No matter where I am, I say, I'll put my story in the ground and the water. Then it'll get to Baba, and it'll get to you too. I imagine the vibrations of my voice traveling thousands of miles, cracking through the planet's crust, between the tectonic plates we learned about in science class last winter, burrowing into the dark where everything sleeps, where the world is all colors at once, where nobody dies. I start again. Everybody knows the story of Rawiya. They just don't know they know it. Once, there was and was not a poor...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.